Ladies and gentlemen, now let me introduce our keynote speaker. We've all been eagerly waiting to hear Mr. Rahul Chhabra speak. Mr. Chhabra is currently India's High Commissioner to Kenya, Ambassador of India to Somalia, Permanent Representative of India to UNEP, Permanent Representative of India to UN Habitat, and Secretary Economic Relations Designate Minister of External Affairs. Earlier, he was Ambassador of India to Hungary and Bosnia and Herzegovina from August 2015 to October 2018. At headquarters, he worked as Joint Secretary, Central Europe, in the Ministry of External Affairs. He conceived and organized the first two editions of the India Central Europe Business Forum, which has now become a regular feature in the Indian business calendar. During this assignment, he was instrumental in focusing India's foreign policy towards Arctic and the V4. An alumnus of the prestigious St. Stephen's College, Delhi School of Economics, and Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta, Mr. Chhabra worked tirelessly to promote foreign investment flows into India. If I go on reading Mr. Chhabra's resume, we'll spend quite a bit of time, so I'm going to cut that slightly, abridge it slightly. Mr. Chhabra is speaking to us from Nairobi, the Kenyan capital. I believe there's beautiful weather out there. What Mr. Chhabra says at this webinar will be watched closely in Africa among those who follow India-Africa relations closely, as he's set to take charge as Secretary ER in India's Ministry of External Affairs. In this crucial position, Mr. Chhabra will be in charge of Africa, will not be in charge of Africa, but will also be India's Sherpa for BRICS and IPSA. He will also be in charge of India Development Partnership as well as global trade and investment. With these words, I invite our keynote speaker, Mr. Rahul Chhabra, to address this audience. The floor is yours, Rahul.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Happy Africa Day, Eid Mubarak. But I thought before I get on to the actual course of the seminar, just a little personal note in the interest of full disclosure and complete transparency. Africa really has a very special place in my heart. What Manish did not read out and was not part of the bio is that while serving in Dakar, Senegal, completely the other coast, I'm at the moment on the east coast, but on the west coast of Africa, over 30 years back, both my sons were born in Dakar. So they are petit Dakarois. So I really have a very special place for Africa in my heart. So on that note, just before we get to the next steps, I thought we'll sort of just quickly to sort of put the context right, talk about the current situation. That's how I'm planning to structure it. We'll go over the current situation in Africa, India's role, how India intervened over the last few months, and maybe we'll take it over the last 3-4 years. That'll be the second part. The third part will be how it fits in with the AU Agenda 2063. And we'll end with the fourth part, the next steps, and the motivation for the next steps. So we'll do it in that format. So let's start with the current situation, of course. A national lockdown across most of the continent. Where it has not been a national lockdown, like Kenya, it's a dusk to dawn curfew. So all the same, devastating impact on the economy, loss of income, fear of contagion, heightened uncertainty. I mean, you know the effects, so I don't want to go over it. But what we need to keep in mind is that it will have huge economic, social, technological, geopolitical impact globally, but more so on this continent, Africa. So we need to prepare for that. Most of the countries are LDC countries with very high public debt, high budget deficit, about 6%, leading to balance of payment strains. Just to tell you that this pandemic here, is particularly in Kenya, has come after they just suffered the ravages of drought. They were in the middle of floods and a locust invasion. So on top of that, the pandemic has sort of come. So it's not really been a moment when the economy was really ticking along in that sense. The forecast for the African economy, sub-Saharan Africa, is a decline of 2.1 to 5.1%. That, just to put it in quantitative terms, a decline of $37 billion to $79 billion is the forecast. Last year, this part, the sub-Saharan Africa, grew by 2.4%. Of course, this is also going to be exacerbated with the decline in international commodity prices. The demand for exports are going down. Foreign exchange reserves are going to be under great strain. The response, AU has set up a COVID response fund, $12.5 million from the bureau members of the AU, $4.5 million for the Africa Center for Disease Control, so those sort of measures will come in. But where India sort of begins to step in is the G20 meeting, which Prime Minister attended virtually. And sort of that call for a comprehensive stimulus package has been well received by India. Deferred payments they asked for, suspension of interest payments on external public and private debt. And not, there was a request from the AU that not to suspend medical supplies. So that sort of the, puts the context of where we are today. Coming to how India responded immediately, Prime Minister spoke telephonically, as many of you may be aware, to the President of South Africa, the Chair of the AU. He spoke to the heads of state, heads of government of Uganda, Ethiopia. So he spoke to several African leaders. That was also followed up by External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar, who spoke to several foreign ministers, including the Kenyan foreign minister. You may be wondering, I mean, just speaking, I mean, these are really very reassuring calls, at least the feedback I got from Kenya, where I am currently. They felt extremely reassured after the discussions with the top leadership. So these calls, of course, many of us have been in this business for long, have an impact which may not be completely evident to the general public. Coming to the second part of our response, India is the pharmacy of the world. We've provided medicines to over 85 countries, but more importantly, 32 in Africa. 32 countries in Africa received medicines, and including drugs which were banned for export because India needed it internally. But there were one-time waivers announced, including hydroxychloroquine and all that. So that was again a fallout of the talk between External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar and CS Rachel Omamo here in Kenya, but in other countries also. I don't have the details as of now. The third part was the request made at the G20 summit, the debt service waiver. India has already got a request from five friendly African countries. And that'll be looking at, that's being looked at very positively. It's as per the IDA norms and the G20 sheet. So that is also being looked at. Going back a bit more than the current situation is the lines of credit offered by Exim, which I don't want to get into too many details since we have Mr. Eskina here on the panel. But Africa is the second largest recipient of our overseas assistance, which include over 181 lines of credit. 41 countries get it. It's 42% of our overall lines of credit, comprising $11 billion. But the critical part here is we just finished a project a few months back, inaugurated by President Kenyatta here in Kenya. And that was a textile, the largest textile mill on the East African coast. What it's ended up doing is today producing hundreds and thousands of masks. So though it was not meant to, so the lines of credit are having these spin-off effects, and we are getting a lot of good mileage and good publicity where Rivatex is turning out these masks. In addition, of course, the bias credit that Exim Bank gives over the last 5 years, over $1 billion have been given out. While talking about Exim Bank's role just a little bit at the end, they've also helped set up 6 IT centers, 7 vocational centers, entrepreneurship center. So we've been working on those fronts also. But while I was telling you about Rivatex, it also reminds me of another incident that just happened a few weeks back here in the Kenyan context, where Kenya requested for chlorine for water treatment. And that was also facilitated. So it's not only drugs, there's chlorine for water treatment. And as I mentioned, locusts. So the FAO wanted movement during the complete national lockdown in India, the first 3 weeks, for pesticides to be moved out of India, and we were able to do that to facilitate. So India has been helping in not only the direct context where you hear about the drugs, but there are other important, very important facets of our assistance. Coming down to the other longer term, what we've been doing is the duty-free, quota-free market access, which you're all aware of, is giving access to African exports. Investment, we are with $54 billion, we are the third largest investor here, fifth largest investor here, but it is also facilitating African exports to third countries and intra-African trade. So in terms of investment, trade increased over tenfold over the last decade and a half, 2 decades. It's declined with the end of the commodity super cycle, and it's now at about $70 billion, still quite a substantial sum with a lot of scope for further growth. Oil price declines have contributed to that decline in the bilateral trade also. India is the third largest export destination in Africa. Then coming to the cultural outreach that we've done over the last few years to connect with Africa, 15 festivals of India over the last 4 years, 12 for the first time, Kenya, Tanzania, Senegal, there have been many countries where it's been for the first time. We're also looking at a festival of Africa in India. We are looking at ramping up the Distinguished Visitors Program. So that's on track. The other part that I wanted to mention was the 50,000 scholarships over the last 5 years. We are very close to getting that figure through. So lots of Africans coming in for India for training. We also have given over $600 million, it's close to $700 million of grant assistance. The last part that sometimes gets ignored, which I just wanted to highlight, are these links that have been going on over the last, this is much more than the last 2 years. Now we're talking of generations. In Kenya, I can speak with authority that's at least 5 generations, is the diaspora, really a living bridge. So the diaspora link should never be ignored in the African context. In terms of that, it leads me to the people-to-people connect. E-visas for 33 countries. Visa on arrival, some of the African countries have already given visa on arrival to us. Air connectivity, over 8 air carriers are connecting now directly to India. So that is the broad connect between India and Africa over the last 2 years, and maybe, as I mentioned, the diaspora. Now coming into how it links with the AU Agenda 2063, it really aligns with India's growth agenda. So that's a very good and a positive sign. We are looking at cooperating at the continental level, the regional level, bilateral level. Multilateral fora, also the IORA, the Indo-Pacific. So there's multiple fields where we connect. Seriously looking at projects at the continental level. There's cooperation in the health sector. 20% of India's pharma exports go to Africa. Bhavatrons have been gifted everywhere, including in Kenya, to several countries in Africa. And the government really appreciates that, by the way. Every time we meet people, we get a lot of credit for the Bhavatron that is being gifted. It's completely state-of-the-art for those of you who may not be aware. State-of-the-art cancer detection machine using nuclear and radioactive techniques. We are also seriously looking at joint ventures, hospitals being set up as joint ventures here, because the medical system here is weak. So that is again fitting in with the Agenda 2063. Looking at collaborating with the Africa Center for Disease Control, the Africa Medical Agency. In terms of peace and security, silence the guns, Manish spoke about that. Africa's standby force. In terms of maritime security, we are looking at defense and security. There are new threats and transnational crimes, which we'll be collaborating on. We've just gifted 2 naval vessels to Mozambique a few months back. India, after Congo in 1960, today has reached to be one of the largest contributors to the UN peacekeeping forces here, with over 5,000 currently based in Africa in 5 different operations going on. So in peace and security, we have a big contribution. Mapping of the continental shelf, connectivity, climate change, extremism, counterterrorism. So these are all issues that sort of fit in between the Agenda 2063 and India's agenda. I come now quickly to the next steps. The next steps and the new areas which we could look at collaborating, they need not necessarily be brand new in that sense, but just the new areas. Solar energy, where we need to ramp up. Of course, in the International Solar Alliance, as you're all aware, more than half of the members are from Africa, half membership over there. We have announced over $1.6 billion as line of credit for African members for using, for getting solar projects. The other aspect is bridging the digital divide. So how do you use technology to bridge the digital divide? In that, I wanted to bring again to your attention, just in the last few weeks, at least in Kenya, I have the figures, and Somalia, by the way, the EITech program that was launched. And we've launched special programs, training on how COVID can be treated for nurses, professionals, healthcare administrators. And over 50 people have benefited already in the last few weeks alone on the COVID programs through using this EITech platform. It's done by the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. It's backstopped by the IIT Madras. So it's really our premier institutes that are involved in this EITech program. Which leads me to the E-Arogya and E-Vidya Bharati more in the medium term as the next steps, which is in the second phase of implementation, where over 5 years, we are looking at training over 4,000 students, over 1,000 medical professionals. So for 5 years, free training, all on the digital platform. So that's the second aspect of the next steps. The third one is traditional medicines. So it's an area where even Europe is picking up fast. So I think Africa should also like our Ayush sort of alternatives to normal conventional medicine. So we're looking at that. We're looking at the blue economy. Another very interesting part, of course, the Blue Economy Conference was held in Nairobi a year and a half back. So we're looking at building on that. There's also this other aspect of triangular cooperation that we're looking at. For example, France, we collaborated for the Solar Alliance. With the UAE, we're looking in Ethiopia to do a center for IT excellence. And in Japan, with Japan, we're looking at a cancer hospital here in Kenya. So this concept of a triangular cooperation is also one of the new aspects that we'll be ahead. There's also study in India. This is again, many of you are aware that over 13 current former heads of state, heads of government, vice president, just at this level, over 13 current and former in Africa have studied in India. And over half a dozen chiefs of army staff have again studied in India, including the current Kenyan chief of army staff. So these are all very important links. And in fact, we have an association here called the Bharatwala Association, where students have studied in India and sort of get together. What's more interesting now is coming out and which needs to be actually promoted, because India, to compare it to Africa, so rather each country, one state focuses on it. So Gujarat, in fact, we had a delegation coming in from Gujarat, and the sort of response they got, hundreds of students registered for universities in Gujarat in the space of a day and a half. And some of them are getting scholarships, some of them are going to pay their own way. So if we had all these chiefs of army staff, 13 current former presidents studying in India before the program was actually, the study in India was launched, so you can imagine the impact proactive program will have. Another aspect where we are looking at a new area is women empowerment. So there are all these areas, which are the new areas that we could look at as the next steps. As Manish mentioned, the Prime Minister's speech at Uganda, which he said, Africa, we will work as per your priorities. The part that he didn't mention was the first part, that Africa will remain on the top of our priorities. But building on what Manish mentioned about your priorities, of course, cooperation being demand-driven, consultative, participative, sustainable, and not a supply-driven cooperation. So I'll come now to the last part of what is it that is pushing this sort of new next steps. The first is the change in the political arena here. The democratic polity in Africa has taken root across so many countries. So there's a complete mindset change in Africa. So that is one of the drivers of this collaboration. The other few points which I wanted to make was the desire of Africans to leapfrog into the fourth industrial revolution. So that's where the digital, bridging the digital divide sort of comes in. There's also both the entities, India and Africa, are emerging and rising players. So that'll also sort of help construct these next steps. This is, if it develops very well as it's on track to do, going to be the defining partnership actually, with an enhancing cooperation in tourism, medicine, governance, S&T, science and technology, space, IT, I mentioned these areas, education, mining. We have common interests on international issues, UN reforms, counterterrorism, peacekeeping, cybersecurity, energy security. So we do have common interests to sort of build on this. The last two parts of my thing are same on building on this. What is the motivation for this? On the economic aspect, I wanted to bring out at the end, the Continental Free Trade Agreement. It is the largest in the world after the WTO, as many of you are aware, but I don't know how many of you remember. This week, we celebrate 1 year of this anniversary. And with 5 of the 10 fastest growing economies of the world based in Africa, I think I'm not sure how much the Indian corporate sector has actually focused on the significance of this African Continental Free Trade Agreement. So that needs to be sort of talked about more in Indian corporate circles. And the last of the economic change, which actually happened earlier this week, was France cutting off its links with the CFA. This was 75 years back when the CFA was launched, and the entire currency is now being done away with, the French, and it'll be called the ECO. Of course, those in the field, Exim Bank will be maybe aware of it, but I'm not sure how many others have noticed it, because it'll have huge impact on trade and investment in that part of the world, West Africa, where I've served in Dakar, as I was saying. And since I started on a personal note, I think I'll end on a personal note also. I was chargé d'affaires at that time in the early 90s when the CFA franc was devalued by 100%. I luckily managed to save the government a lot of money, but that's another story for another day. I'll exceed Manish's time limit if I go on. Thank you so much for listening, and I look forward to listening to you.